class. So today we will be learning from our Greeks again, and I have already given you a handout on lesson 5. And so this lesson 5 is about the noun, the second declension of nouns, and that end, you know, with all the Greek words that ends with omega and sigma. So we will be learning about the different cases and some interesting things about the Greek nouns. Okay, so first of all, even in English grammar, we have quite a bit of, you know, types of nouns. We have like the concrete nouns, abstract nouns, proper nouns, common nouns, and all those. In Greek also, they have like this. Suppose logos. Logos is a noun, which means what? A word. Word. So this logos, depending on the cases ending, like this one, this can change into different cases, which we will shortly write down. You know, you can differentiate the noun whether it is a subject or object or indirect object, or a genitive, you know, a possessive noun. So depending on that, or an exclamation noun, depending on the ending and changes, we can actually see what kind of different nouns are there in the Greek. So we'll take an example of this logos. Now there are eight ways to write. So for the first, we will write logos. Loge. Logon. Logo. A small iota subscript. So this first one, these four things, logos, loge, logon, logo, logon, logo. I'm missing only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. There are 5 singular way of writing the Greek noun. Logo. Then we have the logo. Okay. These 5, logos, loge, logon, logu, logo, they are singular. Singular. And this first one is the nominal, the nominative. The nominative, okay. This first one is called nominative. And then the nominative is simply what you would know as the subject of a sentence. And then you have the vocative. Vocative, which is simply like the exclamation, exclamatory word, okay? And then the logon, which is the accusative, accusative, or the object. And you have logu, which is the genitive. Genitive or the possessive noun, and this is called the dative. The dative or the locatory, a location noun. So, or instrumental noun, you could even say that. Now, how do we convert this into English? And the logos, you can simply translate it as a word. And then the loge, this is an exclamation word, so you can even say all words, okay? And logon, even this is simply a word, but we will come to an explanation of how you can see the peculiarity about this one. First, let's get to know these nouns very well. Logu, you can translate it as of a word. And then this one, to or for a word. Now, as we've said before, these 5 ones, logos, loge, logon, logu, logo, they are singular. And so we will have another 5 of them, which are like plural. Okay, so we have the plural opposite of the singular. So the logos in the plural becomes logoi. Okay, but still this is the nominative or the subject. Then the second logoi becomes logoi. So you cannot differentiate it, they're simply the same. You just have to know it from the sentence itself, whether it's a plural vocative or not, okay? Now, this logon, the logon accusative becomes in the plural logos, G-O-U-S. So, this is the accusative or the object. Now, this logo, the genitive, L-O-G-O-U, logo becomes logon. This is one of the easiest ways to recognize a genitive in a sentence. When you have a combination like this one, omega and m, or this ou, usually you can tell them that they're genitive, okay? And then you have the dative, logois. Logois, which is a dative, genitive. So the meaning of these are all the same. So except for, you just take, if they are plural, then you can simply write word, you know, take out the AA. Now, this works, this declension to changes, this changes works with all those words, Greek words, who have, you know, this OS ending. So OS ending. Now, if you look at their vocabularies, you will find different words like logos, which have a different with different words but they have the same ending. And here also we have the, for example, another word, this logos. Okay, now what we're doing is a declension of all the Greek words that ends with this OS noun. Now, not only this logos, but we can also have adel, phos. And also, we can have a different, like, anthropos. Anthropos. Okay, this means man. And this means brother, beloved, sorry. So, but what I'm trying to say is, anything, any word that ends or having the same words, OS, you can always decline it like this. Or you can always changes the noun cases like this. And so when you use it in a sentence, you can know very well what kind of cases should the noun have. Okay, so look at this. You will find the stem here, log. Log is the stem, and then what changes is these two words. Okay, so in nominative, you have this OS. So whenever you find in a sentence, in a Greek sentence, you have this OS, then automatically your mind must remember that this is a nominative or a subject. So the noun becomes a subject if it is like this OS. And then if this OS changes into E, then immediately you will see, oh, this is a vocative. So then you can translate this meant to be understood as an exclamation. Okay, so you need to translate in such a way. And then now if this E or changes into ON, then it becomes an accusative. So you can immediately say that this logon, if it has this ending ON, then you can say it in a sentence or understood from the sentence itself that the logon is used as a subject, not an object, as an object or accusative. Okay, now if it is changed, this one, if it is accompanied by this OU, then you can simply say, oh, the noun is a possessive noun, and then this one, you know, like that. All these things which are not the stem, okay, these are the case ending. You must learn to see or by heart this case ending and know what kind of things did they indicate, because this is very important. This is like formula only, you know. If you learn this one, then Any kind of Greek nouns that ends with OS, all the vocabularies you have in your head are also, or if they are all ending in OS. So you can always input this formula, this case ending, to this one. And you can always change it like this. So for example, this anthropos is what? Because it has OS, it is a nominative. Now this anthropos becomes anthropon. See? O-N, on. So what is this? O-N, on. So like that. You can change, okay? Anything that you like. Now, what is the use of this? What is the use of this different kinds of writing? Actually, this kind of writings have a very great advantage over English writing, I should say. The Greek writers, they have more freedom to, you know, to put whatever words they want to use in their own sentences. But in English, it's very difficult, okay? Now, in case of the noun as being subject or object. In English, for example, an angel finds a man. Okay. So in English, what are the nouns, what are the verbs here in this sentence? Yes, this is the noun, this is the noun, right? And this is the verb, finds. Okay. So since angel is singular, that's why the verb agrees with it, and then we find s, we add s to the verb. It's always funny, no? To have, whenever you're using a plural verb and then the verb becomes singular, these are some weird rules that we just have to know. So, an angel. Now, the thing is, in English, it's very difficult, often confusing, I should say, for those who are weak in grammar, to know which one is the object and which one is the subject in these sentences. Okay, usually, the easiest way to find an object and a subject is to find the verb first. Okay, so we located the verb here, and usually what is in front of the verb becomes the subject. And then after the verb becomes the object. So who finds what? Who the subject finds what object? So an angel finds a man. So the angel here becomes the subject and the man becomes the object. But if you inverted these sentences, a man finds an angel, then what becomes of the object and the subject? Is the man still the object? No. Since the man now, you know, since it's placed before the verb finds, so the man becomes the subject now and the angel becomes the object. Interesting, right? So you have less freedom there, and more of a rigid word. But if you change the word here and there, then you change the concept of the or the understanding of the direct and the you know, the subject places. Whereas in Greek, this is very interesting. You know, this case ending, actually, once they are stuck on a word, you cannot remove them. And you keep on whatever sentences or the places where you want, they will still carry with it their meaning. Okay, this will become clear. For example, let's take an example. Okay. Angelos. An angel is angelos and finds his hue. Remember this rough breathing hue? And why we're putting it on the second one? Because of the combination of two vowels. So we need to put it on the second vowel, this H sign. the rubbering sign. Heuriske. And what is this K? Why are we writing K? Because this is a third person singular. So we are writing K. Otherwise, the original word of this is Heurisko. Heurisko. Okay. Heurisko. Anthropos. Entropon. Now, an angel finds a man. This is an angel finds a man. This is a singular. Now, in English, it's so easy, right? To find what is the subject and the object, it's more easy actually in Greek. So why? Because you have this OS, okay, the ending OS, angelos. Now this angelos OS, if you remember the formula, you go to the logos, and what is the logos? Logos, we call it the nominative for the subject. So the angel, which has this one, is the subject of the Greek sentences here, And then since the man have this OM, or the accusative, or the object, it is the object of the sentence. And this is the verb finds. Now, what is interesting here? In English, as we said that if this one changes, the object and the subject changes, right? But here, let's change this one, the sentence, anthropon, hu, risque, anger, loss, okay, or even this one, anger, loss, anthropon, uris, okay, or even like this, uris, okay, anger, loss, anthropon. See, no matter how much you want to change the word here and there, what cannot be changed is what? You're right. What cannot be changed is the case ending. Always the Greek carries with it. Once it is attached to a case ending, it doesn't matter whether you put it here, 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 or even here. It doesn't matter. The angel will always be the nominative for the subject, as long as OS is attached to this word. Even same thing, anthropon, as long as anthropon carries with it the case ending OM, it doesn't matter whether he is here or there or there or here, everywhere. The OM will always tell that anthropon is an object. Okay, now the only way you can change this, if you like, for example, write this as OM, then the OM becomes the accusative. So in that way, the Greek the Greek is very easy to recognize. I hope you understand what I meant by this one. Okay, so yeah, coming back to this fine, the Greek, you know, it's just grammar rules that the verb agrees with the noun, the number in the noun. Verb agrees with your subject in number. So if the subject is plural, the verb becomes singular. If the subject is singular, then the verb becomes plural. Okay. And if the nouns are like, you know, you have two nouns separated by n, so the verb becomes third person singular, third person plural. So you use you know, like the same thing as you would use in a plural. So what else? Yes, transitive and intransitive verb. Transitive, it's very easy if you can read your hand out. It's just that in the transitive verb, it doesn't have any direct object. Okay, the verb remains just that. For example, this one, menu, I remain. It cannot have a direct object. So whatever verbs which cannot have a direct object, it is just an intransitive verb. But a transitive verb will have a direct object. Okay, so this is one of the similarity there. I think this is what is most important is you learn by heart these changes, the nominative, you know, like the noun, the second declension of this noun, the formula logos, loge, logon, logu, logo, and then the logo, logo, logus, logon, logois. And when you memorize it in such a way that it becomes, you know, thoroughly ingrained in your brain, then you will be able to use it and incorporate it into a different Greek words that also, you know, talks of well, different Greek words. Now we have, I have given you, you know, what is this, translation and words to memorize. Please do that. Translation, I will help you as we go along in the in the class, like, you know, this week. For example, let me just do one or two translations for you. Okay, so that you will know how to do it. You've already learned by heart all this translation, the word vocabulary, so the translation should not be difficult anymore. Now we have the first word. I will do the first one. Ο Ισραήλ, κόμμα, θανάτων, ζε, δείτε. Then you have the question mark. So, how do we translate this? Let's just translate this very literally at first. This is O is, you just simply say O. It's a repetitive or exclamatory words. O is Israel, Israel. Thanaton. Okay, Thanaton. What is Thanaton? You will find it in the Greek vocabularies. It means death. Zeteite. So, Zeteite, you have to know the person. Okay, Zeteite. What is this? Zeteite. What, is it a plural or singular? That one you need to tell me, Zeteite. Whether it's a plural or singular, I'm not right. Okay. So, what is the meaning of this one? Seek. Right? You are seeking. And then this one is a question mark. So, if you put it now, this one on, remember, was the one. So, what is the object here? And what is the plural, I mean, the subject here? The subject, even though we don't have this OS, but we know that this one is the subject because the object is identified by this one, OM. Okay, so that means O Israel question mark, are you seeking death? And here, this one becomes the subject, the verb, the object. Now, one more time, this one. Number two, angelos, laon, so ze. Okay, what is angelos? We know it's an angel. Laon is people. So ze is safe. He safe. Is this singular? No, it's, yes, it's singular. Per person singular. He safe. So, what is the object and what is the subject here? The object is this one,